made molasses about 77 years, I believe. My grandfather and dad and myself, I think it's all been about 77 years. I first went to work in stonecutter mill. Then in 50, Korean War came along and I had to go in that. After that, I was gone for about 20-some years then. My dad had a heart attack. He wanted me to help him, and we decided to move back here, and I've been helping my dad and then my life has ever since until he died, and then I kept on kind of a hobby now. Some canes we cut in a field up here, cut good. I never got off of the whole field over two or three times. But down here in this tall cane, it really was hard to cut, and you had to get off every two or three times every row. And when you have to do that, and it gets tangled up back there, and you have to get it out, it's a job. Cutting it is harder than. Making day not too bad if I get to hit.
It's a shame that this is the last year, but it's a neat peek into history that's still going on. It's something we've still got access to now. I doubt very seriously that back in the 1920s or whenever this was started, they said, we think molasses will be a great cash crop for the next 70 years, so let's start making and selling molasses. I doubt it happened that way. I'm betting they wanted some molasses, so they started making some molasses for themselves, and other people who came to visit said, hey, this is great. If you sold this, we'd buy it. And so the next year they probably made some extra, and they did sell some, and then things just kind of progressed from there.
When you get ready to make it, we cut it with an old binder, a corn binder. Cuts it down, ties it up in bundles. Then we run it through a stripper. It took all the fodder off of it. Then when it gets all like the fodder on, we take a front end loader and load it on our trailer and bring it up there and dump it off in the mill. Of course, we load it keen up on trailers and saw the heads off of it with chainsaws. And now we used to cut them off by hand with a pocket knife. And that took a long time to do. Bob Morris. He does the boil, and he's a good hand to making them molasses. Everybody can't make them. Well, I can't do much at it, but I can do it. Not like he can. He's really good at it. He's my brother-in-law. He married Sue's, my wife's sister.
Thank you.
I worked for Burns Industries in Marion, and I was gone for about 20 years. I'd keep a vacation to the molasses making time and take it in and make these molasses and get off. I wasn't working for about 5-6 weeks, and I'd take off and make molasses and on my vacation. Wasn't much of a vacation, was it?
They say it takes 9 gallons of juice to make a gallon of molasses.
That's the freshest we've ever had.
That's about as fresh as you can get, isn't it?
Now, how many gallons of molasses would you process in a year?
Well, we probably got about 1,000 last year, but we figured we wouldn't make over 300 this year, but I believe we will. We'll probably make 4 or 5.
My grandfather's blacksmith shop. Back then, I'd save bottles. You take bottles 3 cents a piece in the town, you know, you sell them. And I'd save bottles, and in the town I'd go and sell the bottles. That made a lot of extra money for me.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Back then, 3 cents.
Yeah.
That was in the 50s, 52, 53,
54. Yeah.
So that was...
That was good then, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I think Leroy, he's been a hippie about 20-some years, and Ben about 20-some.
The used stalks, which we call pummies, are taken away as compost.
I think he'd been there last year. I don't think he did a couple of years he'd been there.
Basically, plant cane in the spring and grow it. Hopefully you have good weather all year long. And in the fall, cane gets cut, goes through a squeezer, squeeze the juice out, and the juice gets chilled overnight. They start cooking it the next day, early in the morning. They cook it in large pans, now over gas, used to be over wood. And as they cook it, it goes through various stages. But as they cook it, it becomes thick, comes out of the pans on the other end, and gets put in a jar, and from there gets sold.
The temperature is 245, 250, but it's not near that hot yet.
Well, Roy,
his back is hurting him. Said he'd try to be ready tomorrow.
About to keep it running, that plumbing runner.
It's about those 6 or 8 people to operate it. If it don't show up, it means that it, you're just going to have to go without. Do 2 or 3 jobs there. And it's hard to do without them. You have to have somebody to grind it to feed your meal with. You have to have somebody run those pummies. Comes out, hits the conveyor belt. You have to have somebody on a trailer. Somebody has to be there most of the time to make them plumbers run that conveyor belt, and you got to have 1 or 2 people laying it up. And Bob, you got to have somebody to measure the molasses up down there. Then you need somebody to draw the tractors around, dump the plumbers off, bring the cane down. And we got power in about 1947. We first got power. We got a refrigerator and everything, and all we ever had before was an ice box. We had to buy ice in town and bring it to that ice box. That's all we had before before you got the power. I seen my mother put irons on the stove and get them hot, you know, to iron with. Yeah, I don't see how you ever got the temperature right on them.
So who washes this rag in? I guess it's making a mess.
Let's see,
all.
Wait a minute. I'll hold up there.
I'm going to check. 1948 or 49. I met her on a bus. It run between Morgan and Ruffin. Had a cousin driving the bus, and he told me that there's a girl out in Burke County that he wanted me to meet. And I went with him and met Sue on that bus and talked her into a date, I guess. And first thing you know, I guess we got married later.
Now, we lived away our first year's marriage, and I enjoyed that. And it took me a while to adjust back here, but I love every bit of it. I grew up in a big family, and our mother died. So for years there, we didn't have anybody. My oldest sister had to be. She was a housekeeper. And my dad, he was in the lumber business, and he had sawmills, and he would have to take us to the sawmill camps with him. During the week we stayed, we went in on Monday morning to him, the sawmill, and all week long, we just played around in the woods around the sawmill all week until Friday. And we had the little oil burners. They cooked. We had my oldest sister do the cooking. And we just stayed at sawmill camps. And then on Friday afternoon, we'd get to come home for the weekend. So he moved, you know, that like sawmill, and you move wherever you can get timber, buy timber. So we were just all around in the sawmill camps.
That mill won't tighten no more.
Yeah,
That day, Leroy, he didn't come in. I had loaded pumice on that trailer to try to keep him loaded on that and try to run him up the conveyor too. And that day, it was hard to run up that conveyor. I don't know, some came is different than others. Somebody runs that conveyor belt pretty good. You don't give you much trouble. But I had to do both of them jobs, bring the cane down, dump the pumice off, and I had a job that day. We sell them right there at the store. All we make, we could sell twice as many as we got. We could, if we had them.
That's 68 gallon. Y'all, come on. Come on down here. Josh, come on down here. Help me unload.
Because they've been selling our first. All these years, so these people come, it's been coming there for years and years, 30 years, I guess. It's about Molasses every year. When my mother sold Molasses, I think Molasses is about all they had in the store at that time. One time they had not in that building, an older building, they had a wooden building, it burned down. They sold groceries out of there one time. Molasses too out there. Of course, way back when they had them, I guess that was a dirt road through here. I can remember that when they paved this road through here. And they probably done that in the 40s. And I seen this road so bad, you couldn't even get to it in the wintertime. My dad hauled a lot of these molasses and he had a rail. But he got so he could just sell them all at home and quit that running. We always had water come in from a spring with that in the house, but he didn't have any power. And I used to have an uncle that lived in Iceville, a great uncle, and he'd come over here and we didn't have no power, and he used to electric. And he'd just raise sand. He couldn't say, you can't see how you see anything. And we used to laugh at him when he said, oh, he just wanted to be biggity, you know. And he could see it, but I found out why he'd say that. You couldn't see nothing by the old lamp, but we made it somehow.
Well, I don't know why you boys want to quit, because there ain't that much work to it.
Ain't nobody does that no more, does it?
No.
You and JB.
You quit.
I'm done. Okay, come back, fellas. Thank you.
right, that's 90.
Yeah.
Them boys give out.
We'll have to run the water out of here in the morning and clean them. But we'll rub it down now, so it'll be easy done tomorrow. We don't have to do nothing on it. Take a hose to it.
All right. That's it.
That's it.
The molasses is sold in the store that the family's been running for much longer than I've been on the earth, down on Highway 64, Cane Creek, same place it's always been. You could always count on people coming in the store during molasses making season to get their molasses. They were excited. This was the time of year they waited on. You know, they'd been without since they ran out from last year, and they were ready to get more, and they were always happy to come in and do it. So it was just always nice seeing those folks. I remember when I was a little kid, people coming in, they'd be there for their 15th or 16th year in a row, having stopped by on some trip way back when, and they decided to stop by every year so they could get their molasses.
After Miles' dad passed away, then his mother needed us more, and that's when I added the gift shop to the molasses, because me and Miles helped his mother. I just got to liking it, you know. I love people, and it just worked out real good for us. And after I retired, then is when it really went to work in there. And she helped me for a while there because she sold molasses till she was 85 years old. She even worked the store. I didn't have a lot in there, but she helped me. And after I retired then, me and Mal just took over. Like yesterday, I had a bottle in the store. The first thing I done was I bought some dishes. I started out selling just dishes. And then I got to adding all these other things. That went so well, then I put the baskets in. And that went well, so then I got to adding the dolls and just all this other stuff, the gifts.
I can remember them making molasses and how much fun it was to go to the store, help sell the molasses, see all the people through the years.
You got to learn a lot about what it was like to buy and sell stuff. It seems kind of simple, I guess, but it's really not the simplest of things. Records have to be kept of what you've bought and sold. One of the best insights I think we have to the business back before 1950 is that letter from a guy in Montana who had a firsthand sample of the molasses, and he happened to have a general store. He liked the molasses so much, he was willing to buy them and have them ship 2,600 miles so he could sell them in his store. He talks about his store being on a new highway that was built that had a lot of traffic because it took traffic off the old Yellowstone Trail. That really says a lot there about how little was developed in places like Montana at the times these things were happening. Yet people out there were able to get word of these molasses and try them and want to buy them.
There, I was amazed, even in the early 60s when I was a young teenager, of people that had stopped by here on our first trip to the mountains from all over the United States, and they would plan their vacation so they could make a trip by just to buy molasses.
Miles, you tell them about you used to have to peddle these molasses, take them, go to Boone, and have to camp out at night.
They used to have a T-model truck, I believe it was, and it took them to Boone, and they'd camp out up on the mountain somewhere for night and to sell these molasses. Then they were hard to sell. But I remember me and Dad used to go with him when I was small to go with molasses. We'd be gone all day. You'd go to Lenore, North Wilkesboro, and Hickory, and it'd take us all day to make that round. We'd probably sell 100 gallons on the round on the trip.
One thing Miles' mother told me that really has stuck with me. She said one year it was getting real cold and they hadn't finished making molasses and said they went out that morning, her and Ethel, I think, and said it was so cold that they had to hang up blankets and they had a little heater up there to heat the place up. And she said, right as they drew off the last jar of molasses, it started snowing. And she said a man backed his truck up. They had made about 3,300 gallons of molasses that year. Backed his truck up and hauled off the last molasses. Said they didn't have any molasses left. But it was real cold. And I thought that was really something, you know, selling them like that.
Tell us about making Grandma and Grandpa's signs.
I'd kind of played around with making signs, and so I had the honor of helping them out one season with the signs. It was a thrill for us to come up with my daughters, and you know, there's the signs that, you know, their daddy made to help out their grandparents, and so that meant a lot to us.
I don't ever remember having any more fun doing anything than working one-on-one with my grandpa. He could make it so interesting, and just he'd talk to you all day and keep you talking, and you're working hard, but you didn't even realize it.
Didn't know you were doing it.
That's right.
Did not know you were doing it.
Somehow Grandma and Grandpa got all the work done, but they got up, 4 o'clock in the morning some mornings to make miles, and didn't get finished till, 9:10 at night?
Yeah.
I can remember a lot of nights.
Yeah, because when you see the molasses cookers and all now, you see these gas burners they've got in them where Miles cooks them by gas, but that's only been the last 20 years. And before that, it was done by wood, and you had to get up early in the morning and get up there and get the fire started and get the pans heated up, ready to cook, and time to start cooking it. So it was really labor-intensive when they cooked with sawmill slabs.
77 years ago, how'd you squeeze the cane?
The mill was altogether different than what they are now. They had a big sweep on it. It was up like that, and the mule just went around in a circle. And you couldn't put but 3 or 4 stalks in it, I don't think, them horse mills. And I believe the first tractor he bought was in 1944. I remember I helped him drive it home. I was just about 12 years old or 13. Drove it home from Marion up there. He bought it in 44.
Well, that was some driving that farm-all tractor from Marion.
You could just drive when you're 10. You drove it home.
Yeah.
You drove it home.
Yeah.
Oh, I was out driving that tractor at 12 years old, believe me.
Yeah, I might have been 13. I don't know. I don't remember exactly. I could figure it up, I guess, until.
I don't remember you then. I can't remember you then.
Grandpa used to tell me not to drive a tractor like Uncle Miles did, to drive it like he told me to. He said, your Uncle Miles was a little wild on it. You drive it like I tell you to.
Yeah, he was particular about being careful. He let me get on it one time, and I popped the wheels up, and he never let me get back on it again. That was it for my driving tractor days. I can remember grandmother in her late 80s killing snakes.
Yeah, we were talking
about
that
earlier. Because I was scared of them,
you know? Yeah, she'd always, you just tell grandma about the snake, you don't have to worry about it. She'd go get her hoe and take care of it.
Yeah.
I remember my great-grandmother would say, if you go out in the backyard and pick some apples up off the ground, I'll fix you an apple pie, and I would, and she did make the best apple pies I've ever eaten.
And that was on a wood stove.
Wood stove. Oh, it was wonderful. And then my great-grandfather used to give Becky and Robbie and me change to dance with him in the dining room, and we'd do little jigs, and he'd give us our money, and we had good times with my great-grandfather.
Silver dollars. I think most of my memories are with Joni and Robbie because they were my age. I grew up in Hampton, Virginia. And they grew up in Charlotte, and so we would come every summer and visit our grandparents. We would come and stay 2 months and beg for the third month. That's when we'd have school out. We had so many good times.
Robbie was the tomboy.
Right.
And so she could wrap Grandpa around. Oh. She could get Grandpa to get her doing something out at the shed or something where she could be doing something for him outside. And the other two girls would have to be inside with Grandma helping her, and Robbie's out having fun while she's washing dishes.
I was good at that.
My main point, there was a lot of good memories there.
I think one of the worst summers my grandmother ever spent was the summer that Robbie talked Daddy into letting her bring her horse up here. And Grandma said that Robbie spent all summer that summer riding these hills on that horse, and half the time she didn't know where Robbie was, so she just worried herself to death because Robbie'd be riding all over the mountains on the horse.
Yep. Never let me bring it back.
Nope. That was a one-time thing.
I still remember, though, when you come up here in the fall sometime, after the leaves had started falling, you might wake up and there's no water.
Yep.
And somebody... It's fall, so it's kind of brisk, and it's early in the morning, right? Somebody's got to put on socks, shoes, a coat, hike all the way up the hill to the spring, to the box that collected the water, clean the leaves off the box that collected the water, and then you go back to the house, and then you kind of had to get ready without water because it was still going to be 3 or 4 hours before the pressure tank filled up to get enough pressure for water to the house. Yeah. And, you know, hey, that was just normal, right? It was no big deal, you know? It's one of those things that just happened.
Yeah. I don't know. I just think as a whole, we all just love to go to Grandmother and Grandpa's house, especially Molasses making time, because there was so much more activity. But anytime you went there, you always had a sense of welcome.
Because I used to go up to my great-grandparents' house and sit on the front porch with them, and they could really tell some stories, too, of younger days.
I guess this will be the last year I'll make it, Molasses. Don't miss it. Really, really am going to miss it.
It's sad. I mean, it's the end of an era, 70 some odd years of doing something every year that people in the community and around the community have come to count on. That's a hard thing to see go away. It's an old-fashioned way of making something that's slipping away and gets harder and harder to find.